small, I see this coming. Colt of maximal distance. And highly entangled subspaces. Okay, and I should take at the beginning the opportunity to thank the organizers and that I can talk. And this is joint work with Markus Grassel from Erlangen. Okay, so I will talk about what the connections are of these kind of codes of maximal distance. That means they kind of have very optimal properties. Then they're called quantum maximal distance separable, quantum MDS codes, and it turns out that they're equivalent to a type of subspace in which every vector is highly entangled. Okay, so for this, I start with some simple definitions. So our setting is states in CD tensor N, so N qubit states, and we have our first definition. So vector psi is called R uniform if every marginal of size R is maximally mixed. So if trace is proportional to the identity. What does that mean, or why is this interesting? Well, it means there's always maximal entanglement present between any R subsystems and the rest, yeah? Or less than R subsystem and the rest. Okay, and then there's immediately the second definition, which will be relevant. So a subspace, let's call it Q, is R uniform if for every vector phi in Q is R uniform. That should hopefully make sense, right? So we have a subspace, and every vector lying in that subspace has this property of being maximally entangled between R parties and the rest. There's some examples for these kind of states or spaces. Let me give an example for this. So there are type of states known as absolutely maximally entangled, AME, or also known as perfect tensors. What type of states are these? Well, they're pure states phi such that, these are basically n-half uniform states. What does that mean? Well, we have n parties, and really for every bipartition in this state, we see maximal entanglement. And one can imagine, well, they might not always exist, and that's really the case. Okay. So the definition here is really maximum entanglement for every bipartition. And the question when these exist is for qubits completely solved. So for local dimension D, only n equals 2, 3, 5, and 6 actually work, and the rest can be excluded. So what are these? Well, 2 qubits, maximum entanglement. This should not be too hard. We have a Bell state. For 3 qubits, we have a GH set state. And then we have here some kind of graph states. This one, and for 6 qubits, we have this one. Yeah, but somehow, funnily enough, 4 qubits is excluded. This was done in a paper by Higuchi and Sudbury. And for 7 and above, it also kind of intuitively, the local dimension doesn't support this amount of entanglement that is required. And so the smallest open problem, so to say, smallest open case would be the one for 4QHEX, so 4 6-level systems. And this is a problem which, in the classical case, is related to Euler's officers, where you have to arrange 36 officers in a square, such that in every row and every column, there's an officer of different rank and of different regiment. It's a very famous problem by Euler. I didn't make this connection. It was by Karol Szyszkowski. He likes this problem a lot. Okay, so we immediately have a bound on this kind of states, namely by Scott around 2004. Namely, for them to exist, a necessary requirement is twice t squared minus 1 and 2d plus 1 minus 1 for an even and an odd. Yeah? Yes, well, as I will show later, they form a code, and so you can check the error correcting code conditions for type of codes which are called pure. Yeah, but just like this, it might be a bit tricky. Well, you chose the wrong vectors. If you choose right vectors, you might can do it. That's the point. Yeah. I don't get the question, sorry. Can you? Uh-huh. Yes, yes, sorry. So this is a example of definition. Yeah. Definition 1. Okay? But I can give you an example of definition 2. So example definition 2. If you take this graph state on 6 qubits and you trace out one party, let's say we erase this, you get basically two graphs. Up to local complementation, they should look like this. 5. There's pentagons. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5, and this has like local Z decorations, and the subspace spanned by these two matrices will indeed be 2 uniform. So it will be some type of this R uniform subspace. Yeah. And this is pentacode. Okay, and an open problem is, well, to provide better bounds for these kind of highly entangled states, and also to provide bounds for R uniform subspaces. And of course, well, we can ask a question in similar spirit of this bound, like what is the largest R uniform subspace given some n-partite system, yeah, and given some number R. I'll map it later to the question of a quantum error correcting code, and then I'll tell you what is known there. So basically, this question has an upper bound for stabilizer states or stabilizer codes, but it's open otherwise. Okay, except for the special case when the dimension of the subspace has dimension 1. Well, except when definition 1 coincides with definition 2, then we have this bound from Scott. Okay, so what is the connection with quantum error correction? Let me define it first. What is a code? So a code is a subspace of CD tensor N. Well, we can choose different multiple systems of heterogeneous dimensions, but these are usually considered. And it has an associated distance of the code, small d, if and only if for every So for every vector phi in the subspace following Holtz, we want that phi operator phi is equal to a constant for all operators E that have a weight or the size of its support should be smaller than the distance d. Okay, there are equivalent definitions to this one, but this is really the Knilla-Flamm condition in disguise. And we call a code to be pure. Yeah. If the C of E is really proportional to the trace of E. Yeah. So the crucial thing is here that this constant doesn't depend on phi, but only on this operator. And if indeed this is actually always vanishes for all operators of support less than d, except for the identity, of course, then, well, we call them pure, so we say C is E is proportional to the trace of E. And so we have some notation. We call such codes NKD codes, where this is the number of parties, number of qubits. K is the dimension of the subspace. And d is the distance, as I said, and large d is the local dimension. And then we have a slightly different notation in case. So if this dimension of the subspace is an integer power of the local dimension, so if this log d large k is some smaller k, then we can use this notation, nkd with edgy brackets, where this is now the number of encoded qubits, or enqudits, encoded qudits. So now there's a little bit caveat. So sometimes people use this notation solely for stabilizer states, and sometimes it can just mean the number of encoded qudits is integer. Yeah. Here, I will just label them all codes which have an integer number encoded qubits with such way. So if it's a stabilizer, I will write a little stab next to it. Okay, which you can't see now because it's around the corner. But in general, I talk about general codes, not it's not restricted to stabilizer codes. Okay, now there's a very simple observation, namely that a pure n large k d quantum error correcting code is really equivalent to a d minus one uniform subspace. Of dimension k and in C the tensor n. Yeah? And this should be hopefully clear because we see from this condition every expectation value that lives on less than d parties vanishes. Yeah? So it's really equivalent. So if we manage to characterize these pure quantum error correcting codes completely, then we characterize these d uniform subspaces completely, where every vector shows maximum entanglement across fixed size partitions of size r. And of course, now we ask the same question as over there. What is the largest d uniform subspace, or what is the largest code? And here we have a fundamental bound. It's called the singleton bound. I call it fundamental because it arises out of some kind of a no cloning argument. If one looks at the entropy conditions for a code, or also from subadditivity in another way. So it's really like quite fundamental with that respect. So what does it say? It says that, let's see, I'll write this n plus 2 log d k plus 2d. And of course, now if you want to have equality in this inequality, then this will be integer, so we can replace this by small k, yeah, in this notation. And so if you really have inequality in this bound, then these codes are called quantum maximum distance separable. So quantum MDS. Yeah. Okay, and here, let me continue somewhere else. There's now a nice proposition or theorem by Rains around like 1999. It says that a quantum MDS code, continuous codes, are pure. Yeah. So. So now we. Not quite. I struggle with a really intuitive proof for it. The way he derives it is over rate enumerators and showing that certain terms have to cancel away and vanish. But the really intuitive way to see this has to be true, I haven't seen yet. I'm still trying to kind of figure out the pedestrian proof. Okay, and. What we see now, we have that quantum DS codes are pure. Quantum DS codes satisfy are the best codes that satisfy the somehow a no cloning bound. And then we see that quantum DS codes are kind of are somehow best R uniform subspaces. So if you want to characterize R uniform subspaces, which are not limited, well, which hug the no cloning bound, then it's enough to characterize these codes. And what do we know about these quantum DS codes? Well, we know some bounds for stabilizer quantum MDS. They basically just carry over from the classical case by some counting arguments. And here we have that for them to exist, n needs to be smaller or equal than d plus d minus 2. Yeah, so n needs to be roughly smaller or equal than local dimension squared plus a distance, and now you see it's quite similar to that, huh? for quantum DS codes, or for absolutely maximum tangled states, which are R-uniform, so it's a R-uniform subspace of dimension 1, you have also this quadratic scaling over here. You see, it looks a bit similar. So hopefully we get this. And otherwise you have some like many constructions are known. Okay, my goal from now on will be to derive this inequality for all quantum DS codes, that is for all kind of R uniform subspaces. But first of all, yes. But there's two conjectures. Quantum DS conjecture number one is, I think both conjectures are due to Grassel, actually, to Marcus Grassel, or related people. So roughly, n has to be small or equal d squared plus 1 for, well, up to exceptional cases. Yes. Well, it may be Beth, I don't know, Beth. Okay. And we have conjecture 2. That the distance has to be smaller or equal than d plus 1 for all dimensions, for all d larger or equal than 5. Yeah. So this is conjectured up to some sporadic cases which are power of 2, and this is conjecture for all dimensions larger or equal than 5. Okay. So now we want to really show this. Large D is the local dimension. Did I copy something wrong? No, so I mean they're dimension dependent, right? In the quantum, in the singleton bound, there's no dimension coming in. So this requires that you have always local dimension high enough, which somehow also, I mean, it's really the spirit. So what you want is that there's enough local dimension present that you can support this amount of entanglement that you need. And in these codes, these are subspaces of highly entangled states. So you need like a lot of local dimension. Yeah. No. There might be yes. Yes, but not a complete family. I'll show in a second. So I wanted to show this bound, that this bound actually holds for all. For all quantum MDS codes. That's my goal. And how do we do this? Well, we introduce a concept or a tool, which I call the quantum MDS family. And for this to work, we need a proposition by Rains, again, 1998. So he realized that a pure NKD, or local dimension D code, so again, the number of qudits, dimension of the subspace, the distance, or to say the R uniformity, this will immediately imply a N minus 1 KD D minus 1 code, pure quantum error correcting code. How is this done? Well, proof is somehow a bit involved, but basically it's take a partial trace on the projector pi of Q. Yeah. So if you trace the projector onto the code space here, you project out one part, it doesn't matter which one, you get N minus 1 DK, D minus 1 codes. Of course, if K is integer, it looks a bit nicer. Then you have a N KD goes to, thank you, David, N minus 1 K plus 1 D minus 1 code. Let me give an example, namely this graph state that David is about to erase. No, it's fine. This one. So this one defines a 604 code. Operators of weight 3, the inner product of them is up there, is not, it vanishes. So this is a perfect tensor of six qubits, and from this we can get a 5, 1, 3. We can get a 4, 2, 2, and now we get a 3, 3, 1. Well, now, okay, you see, you encode 3 qubits into 3 qubits, and every vector is orthogonal to each other. So you realize, well, this object actually has to be basically identity. Yeah, 3 qubits. So we see that also because we can get this by partial traces, we see that in this original object, there are no three-body correlations present. Well, we knew this before because we started with this, but you could also have started here. And because these quantum DS codes are pure, we arrive to this object, and then we know, also this object doesn't have any three-body correlations. Okay, and we call this guy here the parent code. And these will be the children of the family. And the moral of the story is here that like every NKD quantum MDS code can be reduced or traced out, reduced to a N plus K over 2 N plus K over 2 one code, which is the identity. Yeah. And you see, well, this is exactly this n plus k is exactly the number that defines this family, because n plus k always stays constant, yeah? Because n always goes down by one and k goes up by one, the dimension of the subspace. Okay, and I will use this to derive the bound in a very straightforward way. Let me state the claim again. Claim is n smaller equal than d squared plus d minus 2. How do we get this? For all quantum MDS codes. That means also for all R uniform subspaces that satisfy the singleton bound. And now the proof is basically, what do we do? We have to consider the two norm of the, say, j-body correlations. So we can define, we can look at all correlations that act exactly on j parties and take its norm, and this is in a polynomial invariant of degree 2, and actually it's the weight enumerator, or we'll define the weight enumerator, and we will go over this. So we look at on a reduction, let's call it, it's a normalized state, which is proportional to the projector of this reduced code, which has a, well, which comes from, I kind of mix the code and the projector onto the subspace of the code. So this code has the parameters alpha plus 1, alpha minus 1, 2. And alpha is exactly n plus k over 2. So this is the last non-trivial code, the smallest one in each family. And we look on a q prime prime, a row prime prime, which comes from q prime prime, which is one size bigger. Yeah? Alpha minus 2, 3. So in our example here, this would be, we consider, this would be rho prime, the projector onto it, or the normalized one, and this would be rho prime prime. Okay, what is pretty straightforward is, because we know that these codes are projectors, thus we know their spectrum, so we have immediately that the trace of this guy is d to the minus alpha minus 1. And trace of rho prime prime squared is mine alpha minus 2. Yeah, so alpha again is n plus k over 2, but I'll use alpha because it's shorter to write. And so no. now we use a Bloch decomposition, yeah. We write rho prime as 1 over d alpha plus 1 identity plus all alpha plus 1 body correlations, because we know that if you trace out one further party, we get the identity. So the correlations that are present in this operator really have all support of n half plus 1 particles exactly. Yeah. So combining this with this insight gives us that trace of this object squared normalized over d alpha plus 1 is equal to d squared minus 1, and this holds for every reduction. And then we can do the same, d alpha plus 2, that's just a normalization for the Bloch decomposition, 1 plus, now we have d alpha plus, we have alpha plus 2 different alpha plus 1 body correlations living in this operator. I goes to alpha plus 1 plus p alpha plus 2. So these are the exclusive alpha plus 2 body correlations. And then we see that trace of p alpha plus 2 squared, so the 2 norm of these alpha plus 2 body correlations normalized, has to be equal to d to the power 4. Then we have to kind of subtract alpha plus 1 times these correlations, so alpha plus 2 times d squared minus 1, there's these correlations, and then minus 1 is the identity matrix normalization, and so this has to be positive in order that this Hilbert-Schmidt norm of this correlations are positive. And then with a bit of removing terms, we get n has to be smaller than d squared plus d minus 2. Okay, and where we got this, we got this d because alpha here, this is n plus k over 2. We got this d from using the equality in the, in the singleton bound. So we can replace, if you have always two objects known, we can get the, we can get the third one. Sorry, which conjecture? Yeah, so this is weaker, right? Because we have plus d, and distance of one is trivial. Distance of two are known to exist always, I think. And so where, so let's say, what this means is we, this is correct for d equals three codes. Yeah, so it's the first baby step to prove this conjecture. Yes. Yes. Thanks for the advertisement. Well, almost. I mean, the draft is there, but. Okay, so this is nice. So I just make some statements which people heard about weight enumerators. So because these kind of purities of the regions, these are degree two invariants and they span all of them. So we can get maybe not completely all, but some. But what we can get by combinatorial Möbius inversion theorem, we can get basically the weight enumerator. It's a of all quantum MDS codes. What is this? Well, these are numbers which have which look like this, where you sum over all in an operator basis over all elements in this in this logical error basis of weight exactly j support j e pi is a projection of the code space. Is e dagger pi, and now it looks a bit weird. But what is this? This is basically the J body correlation norm. So we have this for all, and these weight enumerators are useful tools for the analysis of codes. And because we have it, okay. Well, first this, and then we also know with analysis we know the which is a bit funny. We know the spectrum of every reduction of quantum MDS codes. Well, the n plus k half marginals, they're maximum mixed anyway. So what I'm saying is with this analysis, because all reductions are proportional to projections, you know you have an object, which is an n-partite, you can think of it as an n-partite density matrix of rank k. And this object has these properties that every reduction, you know the spectrum exactly. It's defined, and every reduction is also proportional to projector. So you see that maybe this implies very, I mean, sounds like very strong constraints on the density matrix to exist. So you have very strong constraints on these R-uniform subspaces that they could possibly exist, because you need this kind of the spectral conditions are very tight. And that's about the last thing I was, no, not quite, 5 minutes. So one can get also additional constraints. I just mentioned this by the so-called shadow inequalities, which was also introduced by Rains. And actually one can give a kind of, one can give a a monogamy interpretation to that for pair states. So what does it say? It says for all operators M that are semidefinite positive, or say density matrices rho, we have that following object, following trace inequality, trace of rho reduced squared in 0 for all where the sum S goes over all subsets. Now I have still some operator, some subset T there, and this holds for all T which are subsets in 1 to N. So one has 2 to the N inequalities of this form, and of course we know now the spectrum and the ranks of all these objects, so we can calculate the purities as I did before, so we can simply evaluate this formula numerically. Okay, and so what is cute is that I give you two examples of these families, because I kind of told, well, yeah, one I already showed you is this one. What is the parent code? It's the 6-qubit graph state with maximally mixed free body marginals, and we get this chain of children codes. And I'll show you another one, which where n plus k is 12, and local dimension is 3, where these bounds actually meet the lower the constructions from the bottom, which are known. So one could start with a 12.07. 3 code, so that would be a 12 qutrit absolutely maximum entangled state, or 12 qutrit tensor, perfect tensor. And well, we know from this bound, and also from this shadow inequality, that this doesn't exist. And we can go down until 9.343. It also doesn't exist. So all in here, they don't exist. And then suddenly we can actually have a construction for the next one. 8.433. So this exists, and all the rest until the 6.61, which is just the identity. So this, actually, in this case, it's a tight bound. It's kind of neat. We also see that simply that the fact that we have codes with lower distance doesn't mean we can go back up in this family. And yes. So which bound it was, if it was this one or the other one, I forgot. But the combination of these, I just evaluated all these things. And okay, and we have a lot of tables of these codes. And Marcus Grass has all the constructions for these. So the bottom line is that the characterization of quantum MDS codes is equivalent to the characterization of R uniform subspace, R uniform subspaces of maximal dimension that are allowed by the no cloning. And so what are open questions? Well, it seems that all the quantum DS codes that we know, they are somehow stabilizer codes, and there's no good reason for that. So we would like to know if really all of these kind of codes are stabilizer codes. That means also all these highly entangled subspaces are stabilizer states. And first this, and the second one, if also these codes are all unique. So if there's only one object satisfying this. Yeah. And then one can think of, so we see that this kind of quantum error correcting code thing is really somehow related to entanglement properties. In this case, for pure codes, but also in general, there's some relation. So every constraint on entanglement, say by entropy inequalities, by monogamy relations, by things like this, will give also constraints on codes and opposite. Or one can expect that this works. Yeah, that's it.